Well, greetings to all the brothers and sisters once again. Voice of the one big gang still alongside the one called Metaphysics. Yes, of course, of course.
Yes, yes. Another Monday, TGM Radio, Kingline Caribbean Showcase, Power Reggae Radio, PowerReggae.com. Want to send a shout out to one of our sponsors, V-Pound Music, VP Records. VP Records recording artists in the house tonight. The last two records we played had me in here really moving around, skanking, dancing. And the artist responsible for those last two records is here with us tonight. Power Reggae Radio, once again, I'm going to introduce the man himself, Meta. You see, I have the bio with me, but I realize you've been doing a lot of work. So I'm not surprised the slight change in the name. Meta Jah, once again, is with us. Those last two records we played, the first one featured son of the legendary Bob Marley. Yeah. That was Damian Marley, Junior Gong himself. The second record featured
the Concho Wicca.
The foundation of DJ.
Yeah.
In the reggae music business, Daddy U Roy himself.
Yeah.
We're going to get into this interview with the man responsible for that music that we just heard. Again, Meta Jah's in the house tonight. Introduce yourself to the listeners.
Yes, greetings, everyone. It's a pleasure being here. Greetings, Father German. So,
bless.
Yes, my name is Meta Jah. A lot of people pronounce it the Jia as Dia, so it's the same. It's all right. So I'm from West Africa, Dakar, Senegal. So I moved into New York like around 2001, and that's how I get in touch more with reggae music. And since then, I've been playing around, traveling, going to Jamaica, Europe, and building bridges with African reggae music and the Caribbean and the rest of the world. Yes.
I'm really excited to get into the impact that reggae music is having on the African continent.
Definitely.
We're going to get to that, but before we get there, the name, Meta Jah, Meta Jah.
Yeah.
Explain the meaning behind it, how you came by the name. And then we're going to get into how you started off your career.
Yes. So actually, is my full name, Mohammed Yahya Meta Jah.
Okay.
So, but the Jah is pronounced here so, in the U.S. like Dia when they say D-I-A because of the French speaking. We wrote Jah as D-I-A. So with time, everybody said, Dia, I let it go. Some Spanish people tell me.
Yeah. Okay, so it's basically just an interpretation of the name itself.
Of the name, yeah.
Okay, and you mentioned it's a French interpretation.
Yeah.
What part of Africa are you here on?
Senegal.
Okay, West Africa.
West Africa.
Okay. I have a few friends from... West Africa, Senegal. Yeah. Shout out to my man Seydou.
Yeah.
He out here doing his thing with the clothes and stuff like that.
Yes,
but back to you.
Uh-huh.
The name is your formerly given name.
Yeah.
Okay.
Exactly.
It seems like it has a musical influence there. When did you actually start off your musical career, and where did the initial influence for you to be an artist came from?
Before, I said I grew up in a spiritual family where we were chanting a lot, you know, in Senegal, but in a spiritual chant of Quran. So pretty much that's where I start discovering voice, my own voice, and singing, things like that. And time goes, we were in elementary school, Hip Hop Enter in Senegal, like big movement there. So that's how I started, you know, messing around with instrumental beat and using that voice that I studied in my formal spiritual singing called Tajwid, exploring that with hip hop singing, sing J hip hop, things like that. And you know, I was so into hip hop, you know, that time. In Senegal, they know me as a hip hop artist. So when I moved to the US and I realized that pretty much lyrically, the realities weren't the same in Senegal, how we are more in social hip hop, you know, the lyrics, everything. So I couldn't find pretty much the writing mirror between those two realities. So my English started getting better with time, and one day I played one Bob Marley song, Coming In From The Cold.
Ooh.
And that hits me, and that's how I start also getting more interested in reggae and listening to, you know, Buju Banton, Gregory Isaac, Garnet Silk, all of that. And that's what drove me actually to the music, because I found reggae carried that spiritual vibration, and I realized that as a kid in Senegal and through the hip hop, all of my career, my writing is always focusing on spirituality. So reggae was that pretty much vehicle that I could ride on and express the message. Yes.
Okay. Before we go any further, you mentioned a famous Bob Marley classic, Coming In From The Cold. I just want to send a shout out, a happy Earth Strong to Ras Altrick.
Yes.
We had a celebration for him over the weekend. I just want to send the positive vibrations once again, Ras Altrick.
Lovely night.
Ross Menelik is in the house with us tonight too as well. So I just want to salute him, one of my elders. Now, the influence of the music. I noticed from what you said to me so far, it started off being a hip-hop influence. And I have a question for you.
Yeah.
With that. But before we get to that, you also mentioned prior to that, the chanting that you did in your village, in your community, with your family, came from a background of the Quran.
Yeah, exactly.
Now, I'm looking at you,
yeah.
A Rasta family, yes. In front.
Uh-huh.
Okay. Now, the correlation from the Muslim background to the Rastafarian lifestyle.
Yeah.
Is it something that is intertwined, or is it something that you progressed from studying the Muslim religion, then you went along with the Rastafarian? Explain that transformation to
me. You know, I would say that in Senegal, pretty much we are, how Islam come to us, it come in a Sunni ways, which is have a lot of tolerance and openness. And we were taught that it is 124,000 prophets, 313 are messengers, 25 are mentioned in the book, and 5 are the Ulul Azmi, meaning the 5 with the strong will. So pretty much all of that is one line, one family. So in that family, when the Quran was revealed actually to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the message said, learn. So that means learning is not only in one, let's say, going to just say, I'm going to learn only Torah, but you're going to have to learn Torah, you're going to have to learn Bible, you have to going to learn Zabur, you have to learn Quran to understand the line of the whole family.
Yes.
So today, okay, like you said, you see, I'm dread, Rasta. Yes, that's true, because it's one family. Because if you trace again, one of the prophets in the book, the 25 mentions, David, you trace until Selassie, you see that Solomon, all of that is the same one bloodline.
Lineage.
So
yes.
In Senegal, that's how we were, you know, introduced the religion with. So with time going, I just see that it makes more sense, because a lot of the time, mostly at the time that we are, when you talk about Islam, it's just look at some ways in the Arab world. They have a way they perceive it. But we can never forget that they use, let's say, dynasties and religion, try it mixes. So you don't know what is the message of the book. You don't know what is the dynasty we're doing in terms of inheriting one another. So pretty much in the Quran, we were explained that, you know, the prophets are the prophets. It's not about who's inheriting them, but the message that they brought to humanity, and all of them with books, with wisdom and reasoning. So for me, that's why we are all here, because not just said, I'm a Muslim, I'm going to stick to my Quran. Of course, I have to open up to see what the Bible said. I have to open up to see what Zabur said, what Torah said, because it's one book. All of that, if you put them together, is one book. You just have to flip pages to know the history of humanity and that one bloodline. And it makes sense to the music today that I see with reggae, that I could be inserting all of these messages, and the message of one love, the peace and the unity is right there.
Okay. I mean, so as a Rastafarian sitting in front of me now, do you still practice Salat and stuff like that?
Yeah, I pray 5 times a day, and I do Ramadan, all of that. Yes.
Okay, beautiful. Yeah. I love the way everything is intertwined, and you gave us the explanation for it. Okay, now moving on to your musical career.
Yeah.
You told us how you started out, but the second question I had for you was the hip-hop influence that came into your life. What was the first hip-hop record you heard that made you that bulb go on?
That time we don't speak English, but let's say the way it was, you know, flowing, so you felt, we were feeling like there is a freedom of speech. Some people are releasing how they feel.
We actually trying to actually paint this picture for our listeners right now to understand where you came from with this music. So the part B to that question is the musical influence. You said it was Public Enemy.
Yeah.
Was it at that time in being in Senegal? Did it come by way of over the television set, or did you get the actual album, the cassette tape?
Yeah, over the television. Yeah.
Okay, so you started seeing the videos, the visuals of Public Enemy.
Exactly.
Okay.
And MC Hammer, and many of them, you know what I mean. So, but the time where I start seeing Tupac, Eminem, Nas, all of these things, that's when I just stopped loving pretty much hip hop more, and we were rapping on the street. We had a group there called Chosen. So, yeah, man.
Okay. You mentioned a lot of socially conscious hip hop artists.
Yeah.
So now, you got the influence from them. The music at that point in time that you were doing when you first initially started, was it socially based? Was it social commentary you were doing at that time in Senegal?
Yeah, yeah. It was always in the concept of peace, unity, and you know, this common topic we have together there, which is singing about mom, or this, you know, and how government also oppress the people, the freedom of speech, our education, the struggle we go through. This was the topics that we were using all the time. And many of rappers, like the thousands of groups, the same topics, and yeah.
Okay. Did you have a chance to actually step into a recording booth while you were in Senegal, or did that happen after you migrated?
Yeah, I had a chance to do, but it wasn't a booth. It was just like a room where there is, you know, the old school DJ.
We came by.
Give us microphone. It's like a sound system, and he recorded, so that's how.
Shout out to the sounds that cut the plates in the back of cars in Jamaica and stuff.
Definitely, exactly.
Whatever we can get it done.
Yeah, whatever we can get it done. You know?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Okay, so now you had the experience of recording music in Senegal.
Yeah.
At this point in time, you're still doing hip-hop.
Hip-hop, yeah, yeah.
Okay. You migrated to the U.S.
Yeah.
Okay. At that point in time, when you migrated to the U.S., where would you say, as a recording artist, you viewed your career at that point in time?
Yeah, when I came, it was because when I was in Senegal, I heard a lot about Detroit, because that time it was Eminem, Obi Trice, all of that. So, you know, coming in the States at the beginning, and I'm like, okay, it's happening in Detroit. So I moved to Detroit.
Okay.
Just to make connection and to pursue the music. So
that was a mistake, but we don't get that.
but I learned a lot there though. I have a nice experience there. Because that's when I realized that the reality hip hop in Senegal and the US were totally different. And from there I start hanging out with one jazz player who actually influenced me more to play guitar. So I was searching also myself, because I'm like, okay, not only that I'm rapping in Wolof and French, but what I'm talking about, these guys, the way they rap is super aggressive, is the words, the verbal, the lyrics. I couldn't feel myself using F word example, these kinds of, you know.
I'm glad you mentioned that, because I actually wanted to stop you when you said something earlier. Yeah. You said when you migrated to the US, you realized that the music had a different feel.
Definitely.
What was the change in the music that you realized actually being in the States?
Yeah, I think the F word was my first
profanity.
It's just that, you know, in how societies are brought up, and I know sometimes here some people are using it, even sometimes I would say it in a positive connotation, but in Senegal we don't have it in that way. Is a F word is a F word.
Okay.
So, and I didn't, my hip hop in Senegal didn't start it that way, so I'm like, okay, what I'm gonna be doing here, just rapping, and I know the more I would just try to fit in, it's gonna end up being aggressive, you know, because it carried on, you wanted to learn, you wanted to match the reflect time and how they think, how they say.
See,
so
see now, if you had migrated, came to New York, you might have been influenced by
Talib Kweli.
You are actually reading my mind, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, I'm glad we're on the same page.
Yeah, man.
Okay, so now you're in the States, you're in Detroit, you're recording.
Yeah.
You have the jazz influence, you said, but at the same time, the people that you're working with musically, you weren't on the same page with.
Yeah.
But that jazz feeling got to you, didn't it?
Yeah. That's how I was introduced to a band.
Okay.
And I start feeling a bass, guitar, band musicians playing, because before it was only instrumental. So I was like, wow, this is very soulful. You feel the soul playing. So I jammed with them, you know, a few months and participate in their album. So one moment I'm like, okay, I'm going to come back to New York. Actually, I came here with Sean Blackman, who had a show in New York. I ended up staying.
Shout out to Sean Blackman.
Yeah, man.
Did they introduce you at that point in time in your musical career? Did they introduce you to any other genre? Okay, they're playing jazz.
Yeah,
did they introduce you to any other artists by way of different genres, like a jazz artist per se?
Yeah, I discovered some guitar player, flamenco guitar player. And you know, too, also in Senegal, we have a large variety of music like zouk, salsa, you know, merengue, you know, the mbalax music, all of that.
Wow.
So funk, I was exposed pretty much to lots of kinds of music. But I couldn't fit in any of the vehicles. So that's why when I was in Detroit one moment, I feel lost with the music, because I'm like, okay, the hip hop will start fading a little bit. I'm like, okay, should I do soul music, R&B? But I was still searching. So when I came here and playing coming in from the club, that's when I found the vehicle. So yeah.
Okay. Before we move on to the other question, and we get up to speed with the music as the reggae vehicle that you're in right now.
Yeah.
My last question is, you said in Senegal there are different forms of music that they rock to, merengue, salsa.
Definitely.
Where does that influence come from an African nation? Where is it that they have that many genres of music that they listen to? What causes that influence in Senegal?
Yeah, I think also it positioned somewhere very, with the colonization with France, all right? And the other one with Cap Verde is right next door. Gambia is right next to door. Mauritania is right next to door. So we can get the Oriental music, the Spanish music. So okay. Everything used to come. And Duke Senegal also, is known for that opening variety with music. So it is crazy. We look up on the outside what music is being played in this country. So
the radio stations, as per se, in Senegal, are playing much more than just the traditional African music.
Exactly. When I was like, let's say, 12 years old, I recognized that U-Roy voice on the radio. So it's just like Capleton, all of this, we were exposed because we have DJs. And this one is focused on this kind of music, and it's always rotating in different genres of music, you know.
Okay. You see, now, you mentioned Daddy U-Roy again, and musically I'm excited interviewing you. So what I'm going to ask Johnny Go Figure to do is get back into the music a little bit. Give us another one from the early album. Before we get into the new album, because we got a lot to talk about.
Yeah.
But before we get into the new album, give us one off of the old album. It's been nothing but classics so far. So you can play anything, John. Teach you. Radio. Power Reggae Radio. PowerReggae.com. We back. Couple of good songs we just listened to. And before we move on with the interview, I want to touch back on a lot of the music that we've heard so far for the night. Big album.
Thank you.
Big album. I know you received a lot of international recognition for that album, the music that we've been playing so far. And just for the listeners, so they can go out, grab that album. It's available now on iTunes, Amazon, or digital platforms. What is the name of the album from the music collectively that we've been listening so far?
Yeah, actually, we've been listening Ancient Power.
Ancient Power.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, Ancient Power, was that the debut album from Meta, or was that the final?
The second.
The sophomore.
Yeah.
Okay. Before we get to that, let's start with you migrated to the U.S., Detroit, big mistake. You recognized initially what you wanted to do with your career.
Yeah.
So you moved initially from Detroit. Where was your next stop in your career after Detroit? And why did you decide to make that next stop?
Pretty much I came back in New York, so and I saw the vibration, I felt it, the diversity that was that I saw, you know, and we went to a couple of spots in the East Village, checking some live music, and that's when I realized, okay, this is the place I'm going to stay. And
New York is where you need to be.
Yeah, definitely. I could feel Senegal, I could feel everywhere, you know, the whole world.
When you say you could feel Senegal and you could feel back home, you could feel the whole world, are you speaking just musically, or are you speaking culturally, or are you speaking
culturally, because
food-wise?
Culturally, because it wasn't like the way, let's say, some of the housing are set up in Michigan, so is like Detroit, all of those areas. Here is like, you know, the street is busy, you see people, everybody's active, so that was...
It gave you that feel
that
home.
Feel, you know.
Okay, so you migrated to New York.
Yeah.
You started getting the feeling.
Yeah.
Musically, it influenced you a lot more.
Exactly.
So then you started laying down the roots for that first album.
Yeah.
Now, you started off when you said you were in Detroit, that you hooked up with some jazz musicians and stuff. So you showed me and you showed the listeners already that you had much more of a wider background musically, that you were interested in the actual music itself. The first album, I know you made a slight switch in your band and your career, but the first album, you put together a band It was the first album.
Yeah.
So tell us about the experience of moving to New York and putting that first album together.
Yeah. Actually, the first album, if you listen to it, it was more like still I was searching. So it was reggae already, the foundation of the music. But if you heard it, I insert lots of rock, soul music, African music into it. And because also the way we composed the band, it was an Israeli player, rock and roll guitar player who joined the band, and African bass player, you know, who play African music and few reggae songs, stuff like that. So pretty much I play the guitar, sometimes a little bit of flamenco, African music. So the music pretty much born organically with our influences musically. So that's how that album was composed. The English was also a little bit
wavy.
I couldn't express like myself better in English that time. It was taking me a long time to finish writing a song because writing, erasing, all of that. So, but that was a nice opening. I call that album a passport, pretty much, you know.
Okay, we gonna call that the passport. Okay, at that point in time, what I want to ask you is, at that point in time, were you actually learning English as well as a second language,
yeah,
or as a first language moving to the States?
Second language.
A second language, yeah. Okay. The reason I say first language is because you're moving to the States where predominantly is English being spoken. So we're going to take that as that's what's going to be your first language.
Yeah.
Okay, so the challenges of actually putting together an album and also struggling with the challenge of learning English.
Yeah.
What was that like?
Wow. I guess that it wasn't easy, one part, but one part was super easy because I didn't want to stay in the Senegalese community because I knew that my English wouldn't progress because we would always be speaking, you know, Wolof, things like that. So I went to pretty much Harlem on around 137th Street. So I had some friends from Dominican Republic, all of that, and working at Trader Joe's. So pretty much I wanted to just surrender myself to the English speaking. So every word that I used to hear, like example, definitely, I keep repeating that, you know, watching a lot of film, movies, news, all of that, just so I can anticipate, move faster with my English.
Okay, yeah. And at that point in time,
yeah,
working with the English language and also putting the album together, what the process of putting that album together, what would you say the time frame was all together when you got that finished product?
Yeah, it took me like 5 years pretty much.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah.
So now, 5 years, you put your heart and your soul into that first album.
Definitely.
You put the band together. What was the response from the initial project and when you dropped it? What was the feedback that you got?
Yeah, the feedback was beautiful because we had a following in the East Village in Brooklyn, in Harlem, you know, some friends from my job, all of that. So the album was really underground. It wasn't known because the condition also of the releasing was independent. We released it through CD Babies. So
shout out to CD Babies.
Yes, I bless. Shout out. So pretty much the album was start being discovered around 2010, 2011 by a promoter from Belgium that kind of, you know, give us a big support by taking us there on tour. So that's how the album start being heard in Germany, some of the areas, you know, but it was at its latest, you know, very late.
That's what happened with music, though.
Yeah, exactly.
The music is forever, always for me.
Exactly.
So you dropped the album, initially the feedback was lukewarm from what you're saying, but it grew on people.
It grew, yeah.
Okay, so now you're able to go out on tour, you're able to go to Europe, Belgium, these other places, Germany. You're able to showcase your talent.
Exactly.
Now, from being on tour and showcasing your talent, doing shows, it's also helping you in the band. But in the meantime, What was the feedback like with other artists at that point in time recognizing your music? Did you have artists that reached out to you, that supported you, showed you some type of appreciation, some type of support, some type of strength for what you were doing at that point in time?
Yeah, there's like, of course, like I would say Judah Tribe was here. New York, because we grew together in the reggae music in New York.
Pick up Josh.
And Kingston, the new Kingston band. So every time we see each other, it's just like a good vibration. Yo, nice job, you know. So that alone was very beautiful. And some of the artists that are back home in Senegal was connecting me through MySpace, things like that. So it was in that underground level, and we were there supporting each other, you know.
Okay,
and
so you laid the background, you laid the foundation with that first album.
Yeah.
You received the support, you started doing shows, you started going on tour.
Yeah.
At that point in time, what made you decide that you want to do a sophomore album? What were some of the things that I would say give you a strength to continue in this musical journey that you're on?
Oh wow, I think that the biggest strength is my daddy telling me, you got now my full authorization to do music. Because that was my biggest struggle in the beginning of the music, because how our culture in Senegal is set up. Some tribes, some dynasty, they are supposed to be singers. You know, so if you get off that track, pretty much you are getting off the wagon. So
okay, so your tribe or your dynasty, as per se.
Yeah.
What was the lineage to your dynasty or your tribe?
Yeah, you know, in Senegal, how it is set up, it's like some griots are supposed to sing. They are singers, and there is also tribes they know as fishermen. And there's some tribes who they know are kings and queens. So the kings, they cannot sing, because they said, if you sing, you throwing off the throne, because the griot is supposed to sing for you.
Okay.
You are not supposed to sing.
Okay.
So, and it's a big deal, like with a lot of example, a case of Youssou N'Dour. I don't know if you heard of him. He had the same problem also in the beginning.
You still didn't answer the question.
Yeah, yeah.
What was your tribe? Or your lineage, or your ancestors coming from your elders.
Yeah, yeah.
What was your tribe?
My tribe is Fulani. It's the nomads of Africa you find from the Red Sea to the Atlantic Ocean.
So were you the fishermen of Africa? What were you?
No, the king of Africa, the first dynasty of the Fulani people, is the Jawogo people, which is my last name. So
okay, so you are of the kingly character. So you're not supposed to be
saying. Yeah.
Okay, that's what I was trying to say. Okay, so after the first album, your father gave you his blessings.
Yeah, his blessing, yeah.
Okay, so you moved on to the sophomore album.
Yeah.